Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, viewers, audience, people who are coming to watch Career Growth with Karen. Thank you so much for logging in yet another time. If you're new here, a warm welcome to you. Please watch this episode, enjoy it, and also go and watch all the past episodes. For those who are ardent followers, those who've been here, guys, thank you for coming back again and again, and I'm happy that you're here. This channel, Career Growth with Karen, is where we have all these empowering conversations about our careers. And what we are trying to do is to make ourselves more fulfilled, more rewarded, and even keep ourselves progressing in our career lives. So if that's what you're looking for, then you're in the right place. In this episode today, I will be doing an episode called Ask HR. And why am I doing this episode? I have been running some questions on my Instagram and my LinkedIn page. Some of you have seen that in the past few weeks where I've been asking HR. And in a nutshell, I've been asking for you to give me your questions, all the questions that you have always wished to ask HR, and that I will answer them. And so today I am here to answer them. So it's just a Q&A. It's feedback from you. It's the dilemmas that you have as far as your careers are concerned. I have been answering each one of you individually over the past few weeks, but there are a few questions that have stood out for me, and I have decided to address them in this episode, and also in the next episode I'll be doing the same. So please let's learn from these questions, and as we continue to engage, let me know in the comment section below, what are those questions, or what is that thing you have always wanted to ask your HR, you have always wanted to know from HR, and you have never gotten an answer to. Please let me know, and as much as possible, I will be able to answer you in the chat section. So let's get started. This is Career Growth with Karen. Okay, so there's a question here which asks, which are the most marketable careers for young people who are going into university education? I think this is a question that was asked by on Instagram by either a student who is yet to get into university education, or a parent or a guardian to such a student, or to such a young person, a young adult. So which are the most marketable careers? I know we all go sometimes even into Google. I think myself, I did that a lot when I was younger. I could go into Google and I would just try and search which are the most marketable careers, because no one wants to do a course and then lack a job. We also have heard of the phenomenon about flooding here in Kenya. We are told certain job markets are flooded and therefore they don't need more people. So if you do the courses in those fields, you are not going to get a job. For me, honestly, in my experience as HR, I will tell you, the most marketable career is any career. All careers are marketable. And what do I mean, guys? We have so many people out here with degrees, with masters. We have so many people who are working for us in organizations, but it is so difficult to get people who have good values and good character for those professions. And I will tell you that for free. And the world really rewards value, it rewards excellence, and it rewards character. And what do I mean by that? We have so many good teachers already. Let me take a field like teaching. Teaching is one of those where we have been told it's flooded. There's so many people taking education. We have so many teachers. We actually have so many teachers out here who have graduated with their degrees, but they're not yet registered with the TSC, and so on and so forth. But let me ask you a question. Why is there that we have so many indiscipline cases in our schools? Is it that we have students who are not passing the exams? Why is it that we have students who are graduating out of school without character? It's because we don't have good teachers. We have people who are there to earn a salary, but we don't have teachers who are excellent, who are passionate, and who have the right values for that job. They just have the degree. And whenever you get a teacher who is really passionate about their job, they are earning way more than that, just that salary that TSC is giving. I've seen teachers who are winning accolades. They are going even to New York, to the UK. They are getting sponsored. And these teachers are just from a school in a remote area in Turkana, a remote area in I don't know where, but this teacher has stood out because they are able to go way beyond just the classroom teaching. They care for these kids. They mentor these children. They help these children, even giving them psychosocial support. They work with these kids so much such that even parents are willing to pay extra just to get this teacher giving attention to their children. I've seen so many other teachers who the parents are paying you extra just to get you to give attention to their children because you're an excellent teacher. So for me, I believe there is no best or marketable career. In whichever job that you're going to do, as long as you focus on the values and the excellence in that job, it will always set you way ahead. We know about nurses who are so excellent that they keep on getting opportunities to go above and beyond, to go extra to where they are right now. And most organizations are looking for this excellent staff. We have so many HR people, but we don't have excellent HR people. Companies are still getting into litigation because they did not follow labor laws. Companies are still unable to do succession planning. Companies are still taking 6 months to recruit a role. Why? And yet we have HR there. We have HR people, but we don't have excellent HR people. So whichever industry or field you want to get in, make sure you are passionate for it. Make sure you have the heart for it. Make sure you have the zeal for it. Make sure you have the character that will keep you in that job. So for me, my answer is all careers are marketable careers. And if you're a young adult who asked this question, please, as you pursue your university education, also focus on bits about excellence, focus on your character, focus on values, because these are the things that will keep you enduring in that job, as opposed to you just getting a job and then the next day you can't handle it, you get kicked out, we hear your license has been revoked because you did this and that. Please make sure that you're focusing also on the values, and that will keep you in that job. I hope I've answered you. And the other people who are also watching, who are, by the way, they're HR people, they are specialists in this, some of these questions that I'm answering, they really know more about this than I do. So please also help me to respond in the comment section. Help me to respond to these questions as well. Then there is a question on which networking style will give you a job with the increased job insecurity. Which networking style will give you a job? Now, I don't know so much about the networking styles. However, I know I have done some episodes in the past about and talked about networking. I've talked about you making connections, interacting with people in your office and also beyond your office, in your industry. Because right now, of course, it goes without saying that your networks are your net worth. So how would you interact? How would you cause your networks to help you? I think this is what the person is asking. How can you cause your networks to give you a job at such a time? So guys, when it comes to networking, I hope and I sometimes wish that we understand networking not as, we don't use networking as a tool to give us what we want, but we use networking as a means to give other people what they want and to be of value to other people. I think it is a quote. Okay, let me not mention the person because I'm not very sure if they are the ones. But there is a quote that says, you get the most by giving people the most. So whenever you're networking, always present yourself as a person of value and add value to other people's lives. Most of us, we do the opposite. When we are networking, we are just needy. We are so needy. We are just asking the person to help us. We are not offering them any help. We are not giving them any value. All you're doing is sending your CV to your rich uncle and telling them to find you a job. You're just turning out to be needy, and needy people are such a turn off. I think that's something that we know. Needy people are such a turn off in any area of life. If you have someone who is always needy, even sometimes our children, we get tired, we tell them go away, you know, because they're always coming asking. In life, you always get more by giving more. So in your networks, ask yourself, are you just that needy person who is always sending CVs? You're just sending CVs. Some people, even I give them my contact when we do our career coaching, and they just start following up with texts of CVs. I want a job. I want a job. Give me a job. And sometimes I'm like, this person, you know, you're just turning out to be a needy person. How about you find out what value you can give to the networks that you have? For example, this rich uncle of yours, I can guarantee you that rich uncle has an intern in the office. They have a copy typist in the office. They have a receptionist. Why is it that they are not giving you that job? It's because they don't know your value. How about you go to those offices? You start by assisting your uncle with the small errands. You start by telling him, let me take this check for you to the bank to cash it. You start by telling them, okay, let me take this bill for you to the necessary office. And they start appreciating that. They'll be like, wow, these days I have somebody who can do a few errands for me. When I need to print something, they can print. You go to that office, you do filing. You just organize their documents, you know, just basic things like that. And in a little while, they'll start to see, they'll start giving you extra responsibility. They'll start telling you, okay, why don't you now start scheduling my meetings? Why don't you do this? And little by little, you find that now you're handling a bigger portfolio of responsibilities. And it may even start with them giving you a stipend, an allowance, telling you, here is your transport money, here is some lunch. But as it goes on, it gets to a point where now they have to give you a contract, an employment contract, where they will either tell you you are now an intern or an assistant or something like that. So please offer value in your networks. Don't just arrive in your networks and then you become so needy that people are always looking out to help you. And in the circles that you are, even in, for example, in a church, in a club, even in your family, I always tell people those are very good networking grounds. If you are a very responsible person who is giving value, even in that club, somebody is gonna notice it. And when they want someone to work for them, they're gonna come looking for you. I know that personally, I am a member of Toastmasters Club, and Toastmasters is just a club where we go there, we learn public speaking, and we just interact on a freelance basis. But there is a lady there who is very responsible with social media. She's very aggressive with social media and all our social media networking. She puts things on the social media. She engages people on LinkedIn, and she's not receiving any pay for that. But you can see how she's adding so much value to the club, so much such that there are moments when I have thought, and she's a very young girl, she's a university student, and I've thought to myself, maybe I may need at some point somebody to help me handle my social media on a part-time basis as I also try to grow my portfolio. I may need that. And my mind normally quickly goes to that girl. I always remember her and I tell her, this one, I could have a conversation with her and tell her, why don't you help me manage my social media on a part-time basis if you can handle it also while handling your classes, and I can give you this little stipend or this little salary. It would be very easy for me to do that because I have seen her value. But there are so many other people in that club who you don't see their value. They just come, they sit there, they are only waiting to be served, but they are not serving. So in your networks, please focus on giving. And it is in that extra giving value, giving your time, giving your space, that you will start to receive, that you will start also to receive these job opportunities that you're looking for. So I hope that has answered your question. I think this was Martin from my Facebook page. Martin, please let me know if I've answered your question. And other people, also let me know in the comment section down below, what has been your experience with networking? Have you had people who are adding value to your life, and how do you treat those ones? And have you had the ones who are more parasitic, and how do you also handle those ones? Then there's another question here. Let's say a job is advertised today. Do they start to select candidates for interviews the same day, or do they wait until the application deadline? Is there any advantage to applying early? Okay, so this question, I already responded to this person. Of course, I responded to each one of them. But again, I would like also some extra views from my HR counterparts. Is there any value in applying early? This is a question which does not have one straight answer. Why do I say so? It's because for the jobs that have deadlines to the recruitment, for example, you'll find, and that's the majority of jobs, you'll be told apply by 20th of August. Your application should arrive by 20th of August. Now, we normally expect to receive many applications based on the role. For these entry-level roles, you will get so many applications. For more senior roles, you may not get many applications. But either way, you're going to get lots of applications. And as HR, you're going to have to screen all of these. So if you have applied before the deadline, all those CVs must be screened. For anyone who applied before, within the deadline time, all those CVs have to be screened. So I cannot, for example, if the deadline is 20th August, I cannot on 15th of August, I go through the CVs and I already make my selection and I say, I already like these 5 CVs, let's interview them. No, I have to screen all the CVs. Now, can the HR person start screening earlier than the deadline? The answer is yes. CVs and the screening process is just like exams. It's like I've administered exams and now I need to mark. So even before the deadline, I can start to review some and to screen them and to score. And normally we score them as we are looking at them, we are scoring them against a certain criteria. So I can already start to score those CVs. As they continue coming, I will continue scoring. There are other people who, because they are just busy, they may not have time to start scoring before, and therefore they'll start looking at the CVs after the deadline. Now, what does that mean? It means there is no difference for the one who has applied first or last, or there is no way for you to know whether the HR and the way they score you is purely based on them as a person. But you can be comfortable knowing that all the CVs that have been shared within the deadline will all be reviewed, they will all be screened, and they will all be scored. However, we have other jobs, especially those people who are working in NGOs, we have jobs that are normally considered on a rolling basis. And by rolling basis, I mean on a continuous basis, like emergency response. It's continuous basis, and the jobs are very short term. Like, you'll find this job is 3 months to 6 months, and in another 3 months, again, we need another person for that role. Again, we need another person. So for those ones that are considered on a rolling basis, and usually it will, the advert will say that this, for this role, we are considering candidates on a rolling basis. For those ones, then the ones who apply first, their CVs are reviewed, and if they are good enough for the job, then they are already taken into interview and they can be confirmed. But those are jobs where the CVs are being reviewed on a rolling basis. So even after they have taken somebody for the role, they are still reviewing other CVs to also give another person the role, because they need that kind of role filled on a continuous basis. So for me, you don't lose anything or gain anything by applying early or late. Anything else in between is totally dependent on the HR person or the recruiter that will be doing the screening for those CVs or doing the scoring for those CVs. Now, those are the only questions I will answer for now, because I know I have really, really, really spent so much time. But in the next episode, I will be looking at three other dilemmas which I have received from you. And if you're on my social media handles, please feel free to ask these questions. Even if I don't read them here, I'll be able to respond to you either on Instagram or on LinkedIn or on Facebook or on my WhatsApp. There's some people who said on my WhatsApp, I will still respond to you, because this is my commitment to you, Team Elevate. And that brings me to the end of today's episode. Please leave a comment. Please share the content. Please like it. Please subscribe to this channel if you haven't already. I need you to subscribe. That is your way of supporting this channel and this content, and just encouraging me to keep going and keep going. So please subscribe. Please like, and please share, and leave a comment down below. Until next time, goodbye.